I would like to thank the Charusat University for having kindly invited me for this endowment chair lecture. Now, this morning, I would like to talk to you about a topic of great current interest and importance. And this has to do with drug solid forms. Now, most of these medicines which we have today are taken in the form of solid forms, namely tablets. A little bit is also in the form of injections, ointments, creams, etc., which involve solid forms and at some stage or the other before they are finally processed. So usually the marketed drugs are made or sometimes mostly sold even in their solid forms. Now, the next question which arises immediately is the second part of this title, is crystal engineering. So really, what is crystal engineering is something we shall have to think about. And it is the design of organic molecular solids, their internal structures and external morphologies. So the engineering or the design has to do both with inside and outside the crystal. And in the inside context, we have to understand the weak intermolecular forces between molecules that governs their formation in the form of crystals. That's the first step. Second step is the outside and other things. It used to be a small subject 30, 40 years ago. Now it has become very big. It's now become a discipline of various diverse areas. And in the context of this particular lecture, it is of the greatest relevance in the pharmaceutical sciences. That is the aspect I want to touch upon today. Now, the key concept in crystal engineering is the idea of the supramolecular synthon. Now, molecules are put together to form crystals. So when the molecules are put together, they interact, as I said, with these weak intermolecular forces. So, you know, look at this thing here, what I'm calling acid-acid. This is a carboxylic acid group, and this is another carboxylic acid group. So they are put together with these hydrogen bonds. So this whole thing, which consists of two of these acid groups, is called a supramolecular synthon. This is the synthon. So synthon represents the recognition information between molecules. Similarly, you have this thing here, amide. This is a primary amide. Then there is another amide. So this is called amide-amide synthon, etc. Now, right in the beginning, now this is a concept, by the way, which I introduced almost 25 years ago in this article in Engimente in 95. Now, right from the beginning, it was recognized that these synthons are of various types. Here you have an acid and an acid. Now, here if you notice, you have an acid and an amide. This is the acid side, see, on the right-hand side. This is an amide on the left-hand side. Now, in fact, this amide-acid recognition is a very, very old recognition pattern. It goes much before 1995. Even in 1970s, this kind of a pattern in crystals, amide and acid, was really quite well known. You know, this business of the primary amide and the acid coming together. So it is not that what I'm calling here as homosynthon and heterosynthon were not known. They were known, but they were not given these names. You know, in chemistry, sometimes it's important to get the name is very important, because the name gives a sort of an identity and a sort of a recognition. So homosynthon then means when the two portions that recognize each other are the same. And the heterosynthon here below I'm losing the point. Okay, in the heterosynthon, one side you have an acid and one side you have an amide. And so the two portions that recognize each other are really different from each other. That is why it is called hetero. Acid, amide. Here, acid, acid, therefore homo. So when these different things recognize each other, then that becomes now more interesting, and you'll see that in the next slide. This brings us to the next idea, the idea of co-crystals. Co-crystals are solids that are crystalline single phase materials composed of two or more different molecular and or ionic compounds, generally in a stoichiometric ratio, which are neither solvates nor simple salts. Now look at this. This is the first example. This is a drug called carbamazepine, and this is of course acetic acid. You can easily see the heterosynthon here. These two are two different types of molecules. They are forming the synthon, and this is a simple co-crystal of a drug. That's why it is called pharmaceutical co-crystals. And this term pharmaceutical co-crystals was first mentioned in a very important review article by Mike Zawarodko in the year 2004 in Chemical Communications. So this importance of this article mostly comes from the fact that it was Zawarodko who said that these heterosynthons here are very important in the formation of co-crystals. So if you look at this carbamazepine acetic acid example, for instance, you will see that it is the hetero nature of that synthon that allows it to form the co-crystal. So this was a very, very important idea. And because just at about that time, there was some sort of a crisis developing in the pharmaceutical industry. Now, this comes much later in 2011, but I wanted to, the pharmaceutical classification by the Food and Drug Administration of USA was a very important thing. FDA itself is a very important body because it gives certain norms and standards and nomenclatures for the whole industry to follow. Now, there was a lot of work going on between 2004 and 2011 before this definition came out. Now, look at the stuff that I've written in a blue lettering. Pharmaceutical co-crystals have opened up opportunities for engineering solid state forms. See, this engineering word has come. So you see the connection between co-crystals, heterosynthons, crystal engineering, all these things are coming together. And it says that it opens up opportunities beyond conventional solid state forms of an active pharmaceutical ingredient, what we call API, such as salts and polymorphs. Salts and polymorphs have been known for a long time. And usually when a person makes a new drug, the first thing they will start looking for is a salt and a polymorph. So now this is now going beyond salts and polymorphs, this co-crystal. And FDA itself recognized that. This was very important because once FDA gives a green signal, then a lot of work in industry and academic labs will then start. Now, this is again a sort of a tutorial slide which tells you about solid forms in general. This is nothing to do with pharmaceuticals as such, but this is true for all solid forms. So if you take solid materials, they are either crystalline or non-crystalline. Non-crystalline, when they are formed under kinetic control, you get a glass. Under thermodynamic conditions, you get amorphous solids. Remember that non-crystalline solids do not diffract, X-rays or any other kind of radiation. Now, crystalline solids diffract, and then they can be single component or multiple components. So if you take a single pure compound and make a crystal out of it, then you get what is given here as crystal. Now, this crystal can be also single crystal and nanocrystal. That depends on the size. So this is also something to know. Now, when you have multiple components in the same crystal, in the same single crystal, you have multiple components. That's when you get into co-crystals and this very important thing here, salt. And I put a double arrow between salt and co-crystal, which I shall explain to you in just a minute. So co-crystal itself, you can further divide it into stoichiometric and non-stoichiometric. Stoichiometric means molecular complexes, like this carbamazepine acetic acid would come here. Could also come here, hydrates, solvates, others. If you take acetic acid as a liquid, it will come as a liquid. Then you have certain non-stoichiometric things like clathrates, inclusion complexes, etc. Now, these are all important distinctions in a intellectual property sense, in a legal context, and also in a scientific context. Now, please remember, look at this big bracket on the left-hand side. Polymorphs are possible for all these things. And now, I'm highlighting here salt and co-crystal. So when I say polymorphs are possible for crystals, single crystal, nanocrystal, co-crystal, salt, all these things, polymorphs are possible. Polymorphs means different crystal structures for the same chemical entity. So that you must please take it as an overall umbrella criteria. Now this proton transfer, we shall now get into in a little more detail. What is this proton transfer between co-crystal and salt all about? Now there's some more background. Now when you go into this whole drug discovery thing, it is what is called a long and risky road. Now look at the blue section on the left-hand side. You start with about pre-discovery phase. You start with 5,000 to 10,000 compounds which have been obtained through various leads, various computational exercises, experiments, and so on. And then in the preclinical stage, you narrow it down to 250 compounds. Now, from these, you go into the stage of clinical trials, which is called this phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. And these terminologies have now become rather popular even in the press and television, because of this COVID crisis. But of course, this is very well known to pharmaceutical people. So phase one means it is tried with about 20 to 80 people. You give the new drug to about 20 to 80 healthy people just to see that there is no very bad reaction. The compound is not poisonous or has some very bad effect that rules it out immediately. So that is the phase one. In phase two, it is given, once it crosses phase one, it is given in phase two for about 100 to 300 people who are all suffering from the disease. And then the idea is to see that if they get better. So it is now crossing from giving it to healthy people to giving it to sick people. Now, if it makes it through phase two, then it goes into what is called phase three. Now, this phase three is a very long and complicated process. It involves about 1,000 to 3,000 volunteers. Usually it takes several years. See, below is written 6 to 7 years. Phase 1 and phase 2 don't take so much time. It's phase 3 that takes a lot of time. Takes several years. And what is the distinction between phase 2 and phase 3? In phase 2, you are giving the medicine to sick people. In phase 3, you are also giving it to sick people, but you want to show that the new drug is better than the existing drugs. Then this is done in a number of ways. Firstly, you give some patients the new drug. You give some patients the existing drugs. Some patients you give no drug, you just give a placebo. Okay. And then this is done in what is usually called the double-blind method. The person who is giving the drug to the patient doesn't know what drug he or she is giving. The patient doesn't know what drug he or she is taking. And only the results are tabulated later on by a third set of people who know all the process, who is getting what. So this kind of thing is going to take some time. And at that point of time, you see 250 things in preclinical becomes 5 drugs in clinical trials, then it narrows down actually quite a lot to practically 1 or 2. And finally, only one FDA approved drug is obtained after phase 3 is over. So all this takes a very, very long time. Look at this thing below in the thing, 6 to 7 years. So 13, 14 years, all these things take. This is not some shortcut work. So now you will also realize in the present COVID context, when they got these vaccines through in 1 year, for example, they have been really speeding up this whole process. And for example, part of the difficulty that I think this Covaxin ran into is that they wanted to know whether they should give the approval after phase 2, before phase 3 is coming. That was the whole controversy about Covaxin and Bharat Biotech. Now, of course, phase 3 showed that it is actually doing very well indeed. And in fact, some people say that it may be even better than Covishield and so on. But this is a risk that is taken only under extreme circumstances like COVID. So this whole thing is extremely risky, and risky means also very costly, because all this takes time of various people who are doing various things. Look at this slide. The time taken, this is the actual drug discovery, 15%. Preclinical, 13%. The clinical trials take 72% of the time. Take that time means money also. The money that is spent in this whole enterprise is mostly in the clinical trials. Now look at this graph on the right hand side. Now this shows the amount of money that the whole thing costs, and the horizontal axis starts with 1950. This is a time scale, and it goes up to the present day. Now the vertical axis, which is in a logarithmic scale, shows number of new molecules approved per $1 billion global R&D spending. This is normalized for today's dollars. So it is not like $1950 or something. So you normalize everything. And now you see on this logarithmic scale, the number of drugs that are being approved for $1 billion spending has really come down. And if you look at the logarithmic scale, it will look much more lopsided if you convert this into a regular scale, which means for certain amount of X amount of spending, you are getting far, far less approved drugs. This is, I'm talking now, new drugs. So getting new drugs for old diseases and for new diseases has become very costly, very time consuming, and a very high risk operation. It is not, R&D funds also are not available. Governments of the world are also running out of money. And then companies want to make profits. So where do you go? The whole thing is not a very good situation. In the case of COVID, it becomes even worse. Now, this, I believe, the next one comes more into crystal engineering. It's a very important slide from the point of view of our talk here. Now, look at the yellow rectangles. The yellow rectangles represent what's going on now in terms of starting with an active molecule on the left-hand side, going through to salt selection, then a polymorph screen, then you characterize the API, active pharmaceutical ingredient, then you do the chemical scale-up in the process. So here you are going from chemistry to chemical engineering, and then you get into the clinical and pharmacokinetics thing. So to actually see the how it really performs in real life. This is, mind you, this is after all the phase 3, everything is over. And then you get into the process development itself, and then you come to the finished product. Now, this also is kind of, well, this is what has been happening so far. But you see that these three stages, dark brown, this middle and light brown, they are all quite separate from each other. Now, this is what has made the process long and expensive, because it's all going on in series one after the other. This is where your co-crystals now come. So when you get an active molecule, instead of going routinely to salt and polymorph, you may also try to make co-crystals. You may also try to make amorphous things. And then these, and then go for a polymorph testing. Because as I told you, polymorphs you can get of co-crystals also, not just of the active molecules. Now, the computation is also something new which has come in. Even after you get the molecule, you can keep on iterating with computation. And please remember that you can also do computation with the co-crystals through the active molecules through this way. Co-crystal to active molecule to computer. So the active molecule is actually the co-crystal. And you can do a computational prediction for that. Now, so that means this whole process is now becoming much more interactive. And co-crystals are coming right early in the drug design stage, not just in drug development. Now, this whole graph here is going from design to development. But you see, co-crystals is coming right here. It also comes here in terms of engineering, an aspect which I'm not going to be able to get into today. But even in the process development, size reduction, nanoparticles, amorphous formulation, and for example, continuous flow crystallization, these are all things that are happening now. And this is a very old paper. This is already by 2008, all these things were known. Today, a new aspect has come in. Artificial intelligence can come into this entire design and processing areas. So you don't even need some of these expensive experimentation synthesis. Many of these things may not be needed if you are able to bring in artificial intelligence methods. So you please see that this is an area where the fundamental research and the applied research are going on together, almost hand in hand. It's not that first you do research and then you do development. Really, research and development are going on together in the pharma area. Now, we're sort of reaching the end of this background area. So crystal engineering will improve drugs with poor physicochemical properties. What are these physicochemical properties? You have solubility. How soluble is the drug, when you ingest it, for example, in a tank? Permeability. How efficiently does it go through the membrane in the body from the aqueous medium in which you take it in the stomach and intestine? How does it cross the barrier in the intestine to go into the lipophilic cells where it must finally go and do its work? A combination of solubility and permeability gives rise to the idea of bioavailability. In other words, when you take a tablet or something, how much of it is really available at the site where the drug has to have an action? So these things are all a little bit connected. Little bit unconnected from this is physical and chemical stability. You can use crystal engineering through co-crystals to improve physical and chemical stability, shelf life of a drug. Another very active area of work today, which is something that I will not be able to handle in the short length of this talk, are the mechanical properties of the solid forms. In other words, how this affects, for example, tabletability. Some kinds of solid forms can be made into tablets easily, others cannot be made. So I don't have time to do this. Today, I'll be mostly concerning with solubility and permeability. Now, I told you about the Zevorotko review of 2004. Of course, it got a lot of citations. And these papers which have cited this Elmarsen-Zevorotko review have themselves been cited. So the parent has given rise to the offspring, and the offspring sometimes became more famous than the parents also. So this is happens always in research. And so you must see that when a paper is very important, you know, over here, 2004, when the paper is important, the papers that cited also become important. So the students have become more famous than the teachers. So this is also very, very characteristic of good research. And when you have a good academic, then his students also become very good. They become better than him also sometimes. This is how it should be. So you can see this happening here. And we had a very interesting and important, I think, conference outside Delhi about 9 years ago when a large group of Indian and American researchers gathered together for basically a meeting which was only going to discuss nomenclature, polymorph salts, co-crystals. How do you name all these things? When is a salt? When is it a co-crystal? Now, the importance of this I'll come to in just a short while. Now, again, once again, when people start talking about nomenclature, what do you call something? That means a research field is active. So many people working in this area have given definitions for this co-crystal. And it'll take a whole talk just to go through these various definitions. I'm putting this slide just to tell you that this is a very active thing. Even how you're going to call it is important, you know, because it changes the interpretation, sometimes even legally and so on, as to exactly how you define a co-crystal. Let me put it this way. Those who are interested can please check up some of these authors. They're all very, very active workers in this co-crystal area with the context of crystal engineering. And so you can see exactly what they've been doing. This is just a quick search I did. You know, if you take pharmaceutical co-crystal, look at the number of papers that have cited this topic, pharmaceutical co-crystal. You can see the red thing, 2018, 254. Then it's becoming more and more. 248 papers have mentioned it in 2019, 281 in 2020. So the topic is becoming more and more popular. These are some of the molecules which we ourselves have worked on over the last few years. This is actually quite an old slide. It's about 3 or 4 years old. We have looked at a few molecules after that. Now, I come more now very quickly now into work done by our group and other groups regarding some of these properties. So here we are really talking about, you know, solubility. These are all some early papers. You can see on the left-hand side, carbamazepine, saccharin. I have told you about carbamazepine. So this saccharin is a soluble compound. There is no doubt, right from the early days, it was clear that sometimes these co-crystals have greater solubility than the original drug. And now I must give you a definition also of these co-crystals. You have the pharmaceutical compound, the API or the drug, and then there is something put along with it called the co-former. So here, if you take carbamazepine, this is saccharin. So this is the drug, this is the co-former. The co-former improves the solubility of carbamazepine. Now here is a case of a chemical stability. This is temozolomide, which is a drug which is used for some of the later stages of brain cancer. And this temozolomide, succinic acid, is an important co-crystal. Here you can see the succinic acid, here you can see the temozolomide. So when you take this thing, these pictures show what happens to temozolomide when you keep it outside. And after 0 weeks, 1 week, 3 weeks, 7 weeks, when you take the co-crystal, you can see nothing happens. So which means by forming the co-crystal, you are improving the chemical stability of an unstable drug. Okay, so this is the chemical effect. Then, now we come to salts and co-crystals. Now look here. Now if you take this salt, if you take this co-crystal on the right-hand side, this is one molecule, neutral. Here is the co-former. Okay, it's an amine of some sort. This is a co-crystal. Now, suppose you take this proton here, this NH, and then suppose you move it across. This is acidic and this is basic. So suppose you move the proton over, this is what you get. You get here negatively charged and here you get positively charged. So now you get a salt. So by the simple means of moving this proton from here to here, you are going from a co-crystal to a salt. Now you may ask, what is so great about this? And in fact, I remember that a few years ago, 5 to 6 years ago, one of the researchers in America, he wrote a paper on this with a very provocative title. And he said, does it really matter whether it is you're getting a co-crystal or a salt? But it does matter. It matters now. Now, then we didn't know whether it matters or not. But now we know that it matters tremendously in these kinds of hydrogen bonded situations, whether you have a co-crystal or whether you have a salt. Now, here again are papers that talk about this co-crystal. You know, once again, there's an original paper in 2007, which was cited 656 times. And then you see there are other papers that have come few years after that, that have become cited much more also in some cases. So it means this business of salt, co-crystal and all that is something that people are very much interested. So we ourselves had a very sweet example where we had a co-crystal, where you see this is a molecule. Okay, it is called pyrazine. It is called isoniazid. It is an anti-tuberculosis drug. And here we've got another anti-tuberculosis drug, which is para-aminosalicylic acid. Now, it so happens in the crystal structure that this in this co-crystal structure, there are two molecules of isoniazid with two molecules of aminosalicylic acid. Now, interestingly, the hydrogen bonding patterns in this case, acid to pyridine, is slightly different from the acid to pyridine in this case. So here in this case, on the left-hand side, this is a co-crystal, which means the acid proton is stuck on the acid side only. It is not transferred. In the right-hand side, it is transferred little bit more. Okay. So in the same crystal structure, we have the same chemical compounds that have slightly different positions of the salt co-crystal continuum. The important thing is that it is very easy to move this proton under various conditions, you know, back and forth. And problems with this pointer. It is very easy to move this proton back and forth along this hydrogen bonded continuum. Now, we did some more work on this, and which shows that basically, if the pKa difference between the drug and the co-former is more than 3 pKa units, you will get a salt. And if it is less than 3 pKa units, you will get a co-crystal. If it is less than 3 pKa units, excuse me, let me get this straight. When the pKa difference is more than 4, you get a salt. When the pKa difference is less than 3, you will get a co-crystal. Around 3, you may get the kind of situation where I just talked about, where salt and co-crystal, it's a kind of a real continuum. So we had looked at a lot of these things, and we found that this delta pKa equals to 3 is really quite a good indication to tell you in advance whether you get a salt or a co-crystal. Now, another definition which I need to tell you now is about the biopharmaceutical classification system. The good drugs are in class 1. They are both soluble and permeable. Remember what I told you. Soluble means it should be water soluble when you take the medicine. Permeable means it must go across the membrane and go from a hydrophilic medium to a lipophilic medium quite easily. Now, unfortunately, many drugs are in what is called class 2. They have low solubility and high permeability. They go in quite easily across the membrane, but they are not very soluble. The reasons for this are quite complicated, but and we don't have time to go into that. But most of the drugs which are coming to market are in this category. Low solubility, high permeability. A few are also in this category of class 4, where they have low solubility and low permeability. And this is about 10 to 20%, you can see. So the challenge really is to get these class 2 and class 4 drugs into class 1. And this is where the co-crystal technology helps you. Now, here are again some papers of people in the subject. They have talked about solubility and permeability for some of the marketed drugs. And we ourselves have done work on this sildenafil, where again, making a co-crystal with glutaric acid makes it much more soluble and improves the pharmacokinetics. Similarly, glutaric acid is having a very favorable effect on both solubility and permeability. Now, at this stage, let us sit back a little and worry a little about what are the factors that affect solubility and permeability. Let us take a pure compound. In a pure compound, if a compound is more ionic, in other words, higher dipole moments, more charged groups, things like that, they are likely to be more soluble in an aqueous medium. Unfortunately, the very factors that make a drug more soluble make it less permeable. Please remember what I said are these factors. Some charged species, salt-like things, large dipole moments. They increase the ionic character of the drug. And these are exactly the things that make the drug resist going through into a lipophilic environment across the membrane in the intestine. So the solubility, permeability always go against each other in a general sense. And so to optimize both solubility and permeability is difficult. That is why many of these drugs are in BCS class 2. Remember what I told you, they have got high permeability and low solubility. So it is rather difficult to optimize both these things. There is some region in which it seems to match. For example, if you take this compound drug called hydrochlorothiazide, we looked at it. We made many co-crystals. So you can see HCT with so many other drugs and non-drugs also. We made these co-crystals. And we looked at this parameter solubility multiplied by permeability, because these two factors go against each other. So it is reasonable to assume that the product of solubility and permeability should somehow be increased. We found that in the case of HCT, the product of solubility and permeability in these co-crystals is always higher than in the pure HCT. So whatever we are doing by forming the co-crystal, we are in a combined manner able to improve solubility and permeability. And we have to try to understand why this happens. Please remember that when you form these co-crystals generally for these drugs, you are matching hydrogen bonding functionalities in these molecules. Hydrogen bonding functionalities generally tend to have increased the dipole moment, increased the ionic character. They have electronegative groups, oxygen, nitrogen, etc. So by making a co-crystal, and when you satisfy the complementary aspect of these hydrogen bonded functional groups, there is a small tendency to reduce the ionic character and therefore to increase the permeability. But it's not so simple. On the other hand, if one of the components is very soluble, then there may be others molecular features that make that co-crystal also soluble. And therefore, you can increase within narrow ranges both the permeability and the solubility. So this is a very subtle and delicate issue. And it seems that compared to pure compounds, there is a distinct advantage in using co-crystals to be able to optimize solubility and permeability together, which is actually quite difficult to do. Now, various mechanisms have been put forward as to why these co-crystals are more soluble. This is called the spring and parachute model. And you can really see what is happening here. If you take a pure API, this is the pure API right here on the left-hand side. This is the co-crystal. The co-former is this red thing. And when you put it in the water, it dissolves, you know. And when it dissolves, you get really what is called an amorphous phase in solution. And this amorphous phase in solution is more soluble than the original solid form that we got there. So this is the thing that is actually going to improve the bioavailability. And that is what is important to note. So this spring and parachute model will sort of give one explanation as to why these things become more soluble. Now, this is a simple case when there is a drug and when there is a co-former. Now, let's go further. The idea of a drug-drug co-crystal. This is something which has been there right from the beginning. And ourselves, we were slightly late. In 2009, we got a drug-drug co-crystal of two anti-HIV drugs, lamivudine and zidovudine, which are actually quite famous drugs for AIDS. Now, we were able to get co-crystal of these things. So, you're actually putting two drugs together. So one is the drug and one is the co-former, but you can also say the other one is the drug and the other one is the co-former. Both are two drugs. Now, why do you want to put two drugs together in a co-former? The answer is given here in a study we did with what we call drug-drug salt hydrate, norfloxacin and sulfathiazole. Now, I should tell you a little bit about this norfloxacin and sulfathiazole. Norfloxacin is a class 4 drug. It is an antibacterial. And class 4 means what? I have told you, poor solubility, poor permeability. Now, sulfathiazole is a class 2 drug. In other words, it has got permeability but not much solubility. And it is an antimicrobial. Antibacterial, antimicrobial. What's the difference? Now, antimicrobial means it will handle not only bacteria but also, you know, fungi, viruses, and so on. This antibacterial, antimicrobial word has become important again in the COVID context, because please remember your hand sanitizers are very, very mild antimicrobials. So, in other words, you can say that all antimicrobials are antibacterials, but all antibacterials don't have to be antimicrobials. So anyway, we've got the norfloxacin and sulfathiazole. And then this class 4 and class 2, please remember. Norfloxacin, class 4, sulfathiazole, class 2. Now, let's go back to this earlier spring and parachute model. But now you can see, when both the components of the co-crystals are drugs, then you have to make a small change here. Now, you start with the original API, which is a stable crystal, you make a co-crystal, both blue and red are drugs. And then when you dissolve it, the co-former only partially dissolves. This is the new modification which we have put here. This amorphous co-crystal in solution, the whole co-crystal itself is amorphous and it is in solution. And this is very, very, very important, because it is this that is going to govern both the solubility and the permeability issues. If this red was not there, it will not touch this permeability thing, as we shall see in a minute. What happens after this, we don't much care, because this can form a metastable co-crystal. It can wash out that red drug also. Then we become back to the old spring and parachute model. Then it may collapse to the original form. All these things are things that we don't want. We want the system to be in this situation for the maximum amount of time. This is very, very important. If you can get the co-crystal in this kind of amorphous co-crystal in solution, let us see what happens. Now here we come back. NF is, of course, norfloxacin, and ST is sulfathiazole. So this is the crystalline salt. It comes as a hydrated salt, actually. So this particular thing has got some water in the original solid form. Now when you put it into solution, you see the way I've written it, there is some more water coming in, and somehow the norfloxacin and the sulfathiazole, this is plus, this is minus, this water is also sort of bringing this whole thing together. And this is able to go through the membrane. And most important, this NF, which is not soluble, which is not permeable, is both dissolving and it is going through. So it is sulfathiazole is doing something to norfloxacin, that, and sulfathiazole itself is being modified. It was not very soluble to start with, but now it is getting soluble. Now, on the other hand, suppose there was a physical mixture of these two, no co-crystal. You've got these things, physical mixture, you have just put it together, and then you put it into water. Then sulfathiazole gets solvated, norfloxacin gets solvated. There is no connection between norfloxacin and sulfathiazole here. Then what happens if you put it through the membrane? The sulfathiazole goes through, but the norfloxacin cannot go through. So in other words, what does this mean? It means that by forming this co-crystal, this is that one of what I told you from the previous slide, that amorphous co-crystal in solution, You see, there's another thing here. You see, when you have so much water, the ionic character of NF plus and ST minus also comes down because of the high dielectric constant of water. So in other words, all these are things that will increase the permeability. And this kind of a result can only be understood if you say that this whole entity, NF plus, ST minus, water, all this has to be taken as one unit. This now is a magnified and expanded definition of supramolecular synthon. That synthon is the functional thing, that is the important one that improves these physico-chemical properties of NF especially so nicely. So this was quite an important result, and in fact even Hindu paper covered this. Here on this left hand side is Dr. Shanmugh Prasad Gopi, who is now quite a responsible scientist in Reddy Labs, and he is did some important work on this particular system. And this is Mr. Kanu, who was a postdoc at the same time. And they were the two people who are authors on this, and also authors of the patent which we got for this antibacterial, antimicrobial composition, and why it is important to have both of them, why you should also get this co-crystal. The very last example, I have about 5 minutes, the very last example which I would like to discuss with you is about this co-crystallization of trimethoprim solubility enhancement. This is work done by another group. Trimethoprim is an anti-urinary compound which is not soluble at all. It also has some toxicological effects which I shall get to, but the most important thing is it's not soluble. So by making co-crystals, this group showed that it can be made soluble. We have shown this, for example, some of saccharin examples and some of the earlier examples from other groups which I have shown. So taking a drug and making it more soluble with co-crystal formation is not very difficult. Now, what we did is we wanted to make a drug-drug co-crystal of trimethoprim with nitrofurantoin. Now, this nitrofurantoin is another anti-urinary compound. So both nitrofurantoin and trimethoprim in that sense are both antibacterial compounds. And we wanted to make a drug-drug binary solid of these two. Now, why did we want to do that? Now, you can read some of the fine print below, notably the TMP-NF anhydrous co-crystal and its ionic co-crystal hydrate exhibit enhanced equilibrium solubilities compared to the pure NF or simple NF hydrate. Now, NF itself is quite soluble. In fact, on the face value, there is no problem with nitrofurantoin. It is quite soluble. It goes in. In fact, some of the excess nitrofurantoin is excreted. The problem is really trimethoprim, which is actually to be avoided, completely avoided for pregnant women, and it is class 2. Now, what we have suggested in this latest paper in Molecular Pharmaceutics, which came out last year, is that the co-crystal technology is relevant not just only after a drug is developed to enhance or suppress certain properties. Remember what I told you. They would take an active molecule, then they will give it to the crystal engineering people and then say, now you make a co-crystal which will optimize the properties of this very nice molecule. So I'm saying that we don't do it like this, but it may be invoked quite early in the drug discovery cycle. Now, the idea is that, I mean, this is a core idea of supramolecular chemistry, that the properties of a co-crystal are encoded in the supramolecular synthon itself. So we don't take that the property of the co-crystal is equal to that plus the property of this. But the property of this co-crystal is this entire thing, which includes the synthon. And maybe that this synthon itself has to be taken into account right in the beginning, in the drug design stage itself. So it is not that you are given one sulfathiazole or you are given one nitrofurantoin and then you are told, okay, trimethoprim or nitrofurantoin, and then asked to develop something using co-crystal technology to get a solubility. No, not like that. I'm saying that even in the very irritating. I'm not able to move this pointer. Okay. So in this stage, this particular synthon itself is part of the design element in getting the original molecule. So you don't search for a molecule and then say optimize it, but you search for the co-crystal. The co-crystal itself is the thing you are searching for. You don't search for the molecule really in this, and this is the important aspect. So in this particular kind of analysis, we are saying that you have to search for this entire thing. The synthon is as important in the design stage as it is subsequently in the processing and manufacturing stage. So coming back to this old slide which I showed you, now remember, this is what is mentioned here actually. This is hinted by this author in this old 2007 paper. If you take the co-crystal, you go back from the co-crystal to the active molecule. So the co-crystal itself becomes a target. Co-crystal is not something you get from the active molecule and then develop and then say, all right, we will give it to the people who are manufacturing. No. We are saying that the essence of the argument is that crystal engineers need not necessarily hand over a clinically perfect co-crystal to the pharmaceutical scientists in one go from an identified drug. Rather, the essence of any pharmaceutical co-crystal lies also in the structure of the critical supramolecular heterosynthon that facilitates the bioavailability of the API itself. Why? Why should we do that? Because it is the synthon that optimizes the solubility and permeability properties together. This together business is very important. Supramolecular chemistry is all about together. So it affects both solubility and permeability in some very subtle way, which we still don't know. I'll admit that we don't know how it optimizes this. And so we conclude that it is this synthon that inherently encodes within it the desirable synergy of properties, because the synthon in these heterosynthons of these drugs and all that, we know that they affect both solubility and permeability. We know that. We don't know exactly how, and this will vary from case to case. So there is no general rule still as to when it will work and when it will not work. But for sure, there seems to be some evidence from this nitrofurantoin trimethoprim work that even in the design stage, right from the beginning, you target a co-crystal instead of targeting a molecule. This is, I think, some of the things we have just done. So this is still subject to debate, discussion. Other people are going to write. But the general idea I want to give you is that this is a brand new subject, evolving, and there is lots of things going on in this area. And this is something that's going to have an immediate practical benefit, simply because drugs are so costly to discover from scratch. They're not at all easy and it's going to cost an immense amount. So by using co-crystal technology, another aspect which I have not gotten into today is the processing. I have largely stuck to this part of the thing and little bit coming here. But things like, for example, size reduction, nanoparticles, amorphous formulation, especially continuous flow processes, this process development, all this is very, very big for co-crystals. So it's a vast topic which involves material scientists, chemists, crystal engineers, chemical engineers, computational people now. This whole lot of people have to get involved into this very new and challenging subject. So summary, this is just from one of our recent review articles. Entresto, Steglatro, Suglat and STV are all co-crystals which have now received FDA approval. They're all being sold now. So it is not that co-crystals is some esoteric thing which is in the labs and all that. People have made these co-crystals, they are selling them, and so co-crystals is definitely here to stay. This is something that people have to use. India, with a strong generic pharmaceutical industry, must take advantage of this co-crystal technology and crystal engineering to be able to do better and better in this area. So to summarize, within the purview of this talk, modifications of physicochemical properties of drugs through crystal engineering principles are becoming an area of importance in drug formulation. Two, co-crystallization can be used to achieve desired physicochemical properties, solubility and permeability of a drug without influencing its therapeutic efficiency and molecule structures. In fact, it can even improve the therapeutic efficiency because of this. Lastly, this trimethoprim nitrofurantoin work. The heterosynthon encodes within itself the synergistic property of the co-crystal, and it may be used much earlier in the drug design cycle rather than just in the drug development stage. This is important because it could have important implications in the way in which drugs themselves are designed. Now, I just conclude with something which is related to drugs, but is also something which is very important. I am sure everybody who is attending this talk is above 18 years old. So if you have not done it, please register. I know there are no vaccines in many places. I heard that in Gujarat, there may be more vaccines than others. And you can see the nature of this challenge is right here with the small guy standing here and the huge, you know, COVID monster which is coming. And please remember, vaccine does not prevent you from getting COVID, but it reduces the chances of getting it. And if you get it, the chances of not having a serious form of the disease is much more, you know. And for example, here you look at this blue, asymptomatic infection is blue, green is mild disease, this is moderate disease. So this is if you take both the vaccines, in other words, 2 to 3 weeks after the second vaccine, then you are in this position. So if you take just the first vaccine, you are getting some immunity, not full. But you see, if you take no vaccine, you get into that severe disease, that RIP thing. So please, anybody whom you know, get them registered, get them vaccinated. Doesn't matter, 18 years, 45 years, 60 years, any category. And we know that it's going to be very difficult. But this is something that all of us have to do. It's now a national level crisis. And just governments are not going to be able to do it. So please don't talk central government, state government, all these things. No politics. Each individual level, people have to get into the habit of getting vaccinated now. This is a national priority. The talk itself has been about pharma. So if I don't say something about COVID, it is not very appropriate. So finally, I would like to, I think it's just exactly 55 minutes, I told Dr. Abhishek. So I'd really like to thank Charu sir. I'd like to thank my own institution, students and postdoctors who have worked on this topic literally for the last 15 years. I have summarized work that we have done basically in the last 15 years. And a number of things are happening. It's an evolving subject. Nobody has the final answers. But I think India has a good opportunity of getting into this co-crystal business because it is conceptual, it is also interesting, it is not very expensive. This is another thing which needs to be borne in mind, and it is something that can have a great implication, commercial implication, in a way which actually helps a lot of human beings. You know, I don't see, for example, as yet, I'm sure people are working on it, co-crystals of the COVID drugs. Like, for example, hydroxychloroquine, ivermectin, remdesivir, favipiravir. I would really like to see papers on co-crystals of these things. And I'm sure people are working on it, but I think more people should work on these four. At least these four you please take. And then try to make co-crystals and try to see whether you're going to get very interesting properties or... Because it has happened for other drugs. It has happened for TB drugs. Why should it not happen, you know, for COVID drugs? So I think these are things that need to be done and they have to be done. And I'm sure there are lots of people, and India having a large community of active pharmaceutical chemists and crystal engineers, I'm sure we will be up to the challenge to work in this very nice area. Once again, thank you to the Charusat University for having called me in this endowment series. Thank you very much.